that's the right next thing. So I'm going to introduce Jen Palka, who of course, you know, is this kind of amazing person who I got to know a little bit in DC. So prior to coming to Google Fiber, I would suggest we were a little bit of co-conspirators. Jen was at the White House doing very, very important work, trying to change how our federal government uses technology, uses open data, all of those things. I had spent a little bit of time at the Federal Communications Commission because I'm more of a, I have a little bit of experience with apps, but I'm kind of a network guy. Like I'm a sort of infrastructure guy. And the Federal Communications Commission is kind of where folks like me hang out. So I was over at the FCC working on the National Broadband Plan, working on net neutrality. And I got to be a consultant to the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau a little bit, where we did a lot of open data and open things. And I got to know Jen. And you know, a lot of times somebody, you run into somebody from the White House in Washington, and it's not always a great experience. It's sort of, they kind of come in and they tell you to do a bunch of stuff and they don't give you any resources. And then you kind of hope it go away. Jen was the 100% exact opposite of that. And I have always been in awe of her work at Code for America. I think the success speaks for itself. But I think we also all owe her a debt of gratitude for her work in Washington. Because the progress with 18F and you know, all the things that you see in Washington came from the energy and the passion that Jen has for open data and open source. So with that, Jen Palka.
Begging him to come into federal service again. Great, thank you. Wonderful to reconnect. Actually, should I use this or this?
They're both live.
Okay. If I talk to both, I'll do this then, if that's okay. Wow, it's so nice to arrive somewhere and see some familiar faces and some new faces, but to feel like you're part of a community. There's a very strong sense of community here, and I'm aware of myself as something of an outsider, but also feeling all of the connections between this group here and the other Code Fours around the country and the people back at Code for America in San Francisco. And I gotta say, I needed it. Really needed it arriving here. Sometimes when you travel, you're a little bit unmoored. I felt that way this week. I was in airports, watching social media, feeling worried about our country, feeling rattled, particularly by what happened in Tulsa, where I used to spend summers, and just needing to connect with people, feeling very insecure. And I feel much better being here. I feel like after the talk, though, I'd love to talk with a lot of you about a number of the things that are in the talk, and eager to feel more connected and more grounded by my experience here. I don't come to the city camps around the country to give talks. I'm happy to give the talk. I think I really come so that I can understand what's going on and get inspiration. I appreciate it when people say that they're inspired, but really, I come here to get inspired by you guys, and I've already been inspired an enormous amount, so. Thank you for the warm welcome from Lori and Eric and Jason and everybody here and the folks that I've met. So thank you guys. I was once asked to talk about this sort of strange topic. The problems that get solved have everything to do with who's doing the solving. So I sort of thought about that a bit. I said, yeah, that is an interesting question. And I think it was, I'm sorry, I forget the name, Bonner, mm-hmm. who spoke yes. earlier, said, who's supposed to come to city camp? Everybody's supposed to come to city camp. I think there's a tie between that statement and what I'm going to talk about today. I do think that ultimately, if we don't think about who is solving the problems in this country, we can't really solve them. So I'm going to start with just a story about one of the fellows who was with us at the Code for America Fellowship in 2013. Tiffany Bell. She was working in Atlanta, where actually I'm going to go tomorrow and meet with the Code for Atlanta folks. She came to us to work on that team that was actually working on the court system there. They did an amazing project which helped deal with the fact that when you got a traffic ticket in Atlanta, you would stand online at the courts for about 5 hours in order to clear that traffic ticket, which resulted in a lot of people getting bench warrants for their arrest. And when you have a bench warrant and you run a stop sign, you can go to jail for that. And this was a big problem in Atlanta. But while she was working on that incredibly large and difficult problem, she also became aware of the problem in Detroit with water being shut off. And that spoke to her in a way that said, this is unacceptable and somebody should do something about that. And I think she had that moment that many of us have. It's when you think about this quote, I think it's a Lily Tomlin quote, I always thought somebody should do something about that. And then I realized that I was somebody. And so she started tweeting about her outrage on Twitter, and she met up with another woman named Christy Tillman. They had never met, but they started working on something called the Detroit Water Project, which crowdsourced contributions. And they figured out how to work directly with Detroit Water so that the money came in from a volunteer, went directly to paying someone's bill, and turned their water back on. She did this in her spare time while solving the problems of the court systems in Atlanta, which is pretty remarkable to me. And the reason I'm bringing this up is it speaks to something that Mike Bracken, who started the government digital service in the United Kingdom, always says, which is the strategy is delivery. And Eric knows a bit about the GDS, because I talk about it all the time in relation to our work in the federal government. But basically, you know, Tiffany could have gone out there and said, we need a policy that says that water is a fundamental human right. And she, that would have been a completely valid thing to do, but that's not where she started. She started with, let's just turn some people's water back on. Now, of course, she has a platform. She's turned thousands of people's water back on in Detroit and now in Baltimore. And now she actually has a platform to talk about water as a fundamental human right and possibly changes through policy, which is great. But that's just not where she started. She started by just doing something about it. I think this also speaks to what happened with healthcare.gov. As Eric said, I happened to be in the White House during that time. I don't think we were in a very good place to go tell people what to do at that moment. We might have had something to do with a more collaborative approach. But remember what happened in October 1st, 2013. We launched a website that was supposed to help people get health coverage in this country. And didn't go so well. The first couple of weeks, only handfuls of people were actually able to get through the site. And so what did we do there? Well, we brought in a bunch of people. These folks really came in from all over the country. There were some of them already there. Let's see, Greg Gershman in the gray jacket was already there. Ryan Panchasadran was already there. Mikey's someone who was asked to come, I think it was on a Tuesday afternoon and was there by Wednesday morning to come help. And what did they do? They started working as hard as they could. They were, at one point we found out that Mikey had worked 100 days straight, 20 hours a day. And they didn't really start with the plans and the policies. They started just with following user behavior. It was really the only thing that they could do. This team was subcontractors to subcontractors to subcontractors to a prime contractor on the job. And they had no authority whatsoever. They had a little bit of sort of somebody, maybe Todd Park and others sort of standing behind them saying, maybe you should listen to these guys. But really, they were actually very much the bottom of a very, very long a food chain. But out there saying, you know what, it's not helping to go back to the original plans. What can help is that we actually follow users through the site and one by one figure out what is holding them back, fixing that thing, and then moving on to the next thing. And it was a pretty powerful way of addressing the problem. And of course, as you know, it did get a little bit better. This was definitely my favorite headline. as a plan preview feature that occasionally works. But it got a little bit better and a little bit better. Okay, I double clicked. And actually, you know, we think of this as a massive IT government failure. In fact, it was a success. We enrolled more people during that open enrollment period than we even thought was possible before the site failed. That's not bad. It just looked bad at the beginning. I want to mention a little bit, I mentioned briefly about Mikey's work hours. Of course, he was one of several hundred people who were doing this. A lot of them were the original contractors on the project. A lot of them were the original people from CNS and Health and Human Services on the project, were working hours like that. It certainly wasn't just Mikey and his team. But why were folks working those kinds of hours? Part of it was because Todd Park, who was my boss and I guess sort of the head of this group that we called Ad Hoc, the Ad Hoc folks who came in to help fix the site, Todd would gather us sometimes very, very late at night. People were working not so hours. And he would read us the letters that were coming in from people who were accessing the site. And they were heartbreaking. One of them was from a woman who said that she had spent the last 15 years choosing between healthcare for her kids and healthcare for herself. And she had actually gotten through the site and signed up, and for the first time was going to see a doctor the next day for the first time in 15 years. And I thought about the fact that we've been forcing people in this country to make choices like that. And as a middle-aged woman who feels like she should see the doctor every year, realizing what a privilege that was, that really spoke to me. Everybody had a letter that Todd would read that spoke specifically to them. That was the one that affected me most. But it was really that inspiration, the direct connection between the work that we do and the people who need the service that we're providing, that kept that team going, working 20 hours a day for 100 days straight. So Mikey Dickerson, the guy who was in the middle of that photo before, and by the way, Mikey was the guy that we got because we couldn't get Eric. I'm not kidding. Mikey was fantastic. We tried to get Eric in his job. Having served the president, having helped save healthcare.gov, being on the front page, the cover of Time magazine, still had this to say about his experience in government when it was all said and done. He actually put this in, this is a quote from that Time magazine article. He felt like sort of the institution of government had no use for someone who looks and dresses like him. Now, I started the talk talking about racial divisions in this country and huge inequality and tragedies that are happening in society. Mikey is obviously not someone who's subject to racial discrimination, but he's still someone who felt like he was outside of the system in a weird way. And I think it's interesting to track our progress. This was what Stephen Brill had to say about the way in which that project was initially approached. It's almost as if they thought the nuts and bolts of governing is for peons. They are policy people. I have nothing against policy people. I worked in the Office of Science and Technology. Policy, I believe policy is really important. But I think we're speaking to an old way of thinking here that says that the actual doing of government, the tech, the data, is somehow below the work that thought leaders and policy people do. And I would propose to you that one of the things that has happened over the past 6 years, 10 years of this movement of people reclaiming government for ourselves is an inversion of that thinking. And that the people who are really doing the work, the people who stood up last night and talked about their projects, for instance, are the people leading, and it's the policymakers in many cases that will follow that. And that leads me to this question, what is it that we want to borrow from tech? And a new friend of mine last night, who is we? What do we mean we? And I think I mean the movement of people who believe in government working for the people, by the people in the 21st century. there is this sense that we're bringing something from tech into government. And I think that that's partly true. We want to bring some of what we see in the tech world into government. In San Francisco, where I live, there's a lot of discussion about what we don't want to bring from tech into government. There's a lot of arrogance and inequality in tech that is not part of what we want to bring into this movement. But I think the core thing that we're trying to bring in, again, is expressed by our friends at the Government Digital Service in the UK, which is a different process, a process that starts with users. So in the old process, we start with policy, then we have processes on, then we build very large systems to do these things. Then and only then do we check in with users, and then it results in something that is sort of a stasis that generally people are relatively unsatisfied with. But in the old process, that's the end, and that's the thing you've got. So the new process that we're trying to follow, sorry guys, there we go, must start with users. That is the fundamental thing I think all of us here today who are coming, bringing tech and government together, can fundamentally agree on. We start with understanding what it is our users need. Then we either design or redesign services around those users. Then there's the development of systems. Then a check on policy. Is policy working in service of the people? Not are we developing a service to fit the policy? And then very, very importantly, what is the feedback loop so that we know what's working and what's not? How do we continuously iterate on these services or processes or whatever it is, such that we know in an ongoing way whether they continue to fit the needs of the people? That, to me, is fundamentally the core of what we're doing here together in tech and government. Now, I think that's really what the team at healthcare.gov did. It's certainly what Tiffany did. It's what all of you here are doing. And the thing about healthcare.gov that made it such big news is not that it was a failed IT project in government. That's frankly not news, especially at the federal level. What was news is that middle class people were asked to use it. And Ezra Klein very appropriately pointed out at that time that in fact, if you're poor in America today, you are dealing with something as bad as healthcare.gov almost every day. We had a little bit of experience with this in Code for America starting in 2013, and it's really now become the focus of our work through the fellowship and through some of the projects that we're now emerging out of the fellowship and taking to scale. You probably are aware that we, through the fellowship and of course the brigades, have worked in probably any area that local government touches. Now, the projects that we are doing in San Francisco through the teams there are focused exclusively on government services that touch our most vulnerable populations. And it's partly because we got to start this work in 2013 in the court system in Atlanta, and then in San Francisco in the food stamps work. So I just wanted to talk about that for a little bit. The team that worked on food stamps in 2013 was asked actually to deal with churn in the program. So people would sign up for food stamps, and then they would very quickly fall off of it. And the data, aggregate level data in the program, could show this. And I said, we know we've got a problem here. Can you help us figure out what's going wrong? So the team actually signed up for food stamps, and they started getting all the letters that you get when you're on the program. And I actually often read this to people. Should I torture you this morning? Do a little torture? I'm going to read you this. Your food stamps benefit this quarter did not change as a result of the documents and information we received because it would not have resulted in an increase in benefits. Your food stamp benefit in this quarter did not change as a result of the documents and information we received because the new rule says that when you report some changes, the county cannot lower your food stamps until the next quarter. The county has refigured your food stamps using the information reported and the food stamp amount did not go up. It goes on. So there's about four pages of this that you get at some point after you're enrolled. What you don't know, because you can keep reading it, what you don't know is that it's asking you to send in additional documentation. And if you don't send that in, then you're going to end up at the front of the line at the grocery store, and you're going to slide that EBT card, and it's going to go, you don't have an EBT because you've actually fallen off the program and you don't know it. And you don't know it because that letter doesn't make any sense whatsoever. There's a lot of letters like that. They kind of all sound that way. So that team started by saying, look, we can't get the letters changed. Apparently it's really hard to change the legalese. But we can start collecting cell phone numbers, which was not easy. That was probably the biggest win that that team had, is actually getting the agreement to collect cell phone numbers from food stamp recipients in San Francisco. And then the ability to send them a text message when they were in jeopardy of falling off the rolls. And very simple, very straightforward. Your CalFresh benefits may stop at the end of this month. Please call us. So in that pilot, 40% fewer people fell off the rolls because they got the text message and called in. But that team said, so that team sort of finished, you guys know that the fellowship, it's like a year-long thing. You're doing your year of service, and then it's over. And you're supposed to go get another job. Actually, most of them, fellows now go into government. They go into local government, they go to 18F, they go to USDS. Well, this team was like, no, 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 we're not done. We've seen a lot that needs to be fixed here, and we're going to stick around. And in fact, I was actually, so they finished in November 2013. I was still in federal government working on the United States Digital Service and 18F. I came back, and these guys were sort of still there. One of them was real skinny, a lot skinnier. And I said, Alan, what's going on? He said, well, I'm not getting paid. And I'm living entirely on benefits so that I can understand how people in this country live on benefits. Like, we need to start paying you and we need to start feeding you. But one of the things that they felt was really unfinished business and wouldn't leave Code for America until they had done was that they were working on sort of the middle part of the problem, the churn in the program. But what they knew was that so California has one of the lowest rates of participation in this program in the country. The only state with fewer people enrolled of the eligible population is Wyoming, which is very small compared to California. And one of the reasons so few eligible people are on CalFresh, which is our state's nutrition assistance program, is that it's really, really hard to get on. This is, if who's on PowerPoint, you can see this animation. The application form online is 52 screens long, asks 200 and something questions, and the questions are really difficult to understand. Some of them are also, frankly, very intimidating and insulting. They ask you a lot of questions about your history of selling food stamps for drugs, ammunition, or guns, which I just don't think is relevant to most people. So they decided that they would do something about that. And actually, this is the newest version of it. I guess that's actually an animating. It's a simple mobile. So the way that you're supposed to apply online right now does not work on a mobile phone at all, and most people don't have access necessarily. We've talked about broadband access. Thank you for the broadband access you brought to this community. But in California, if you want people to use an online form in your low-income population, you really need to have it work on a mobile phone. So our team's created a really simple, clear, easy application that works on the mobile phone. It asks you a lot of reasonable questions. And it actually deals with the issues that people have, including the fact that a lot of people who are applying for food stamps don't have a stable address. So we've dealt with, figured out ways to deal with this so that we're still being able to get them through the process. We text message with all the people after they're in the program. And what we're doing now actually is rolling this program out to every California county. It's gone from being an experiment that works and sort of shows what's possible to something that scales. The state is paying us to do it, so we'll be sustainable long term. And our goal is in the next 2 years to close that participation gap in California by at least a third. One last story, and you guys probably know about this one, but to illustrate our point about people coming together, this is a project that happened in 2013 in New Orleans. One of these stories, because if so, I'll skip it. This is an older story from New Orleans. Anybody already hear it? Okay, just one person, so I'll go ahead and tell you. So Mayor Landrieu in New Orleans asked us to look at the problem of blighted properties because he could stand in front of a blighted property in New Orleans. There was no way for him to understand whether that property had been reported for blight, whether it had been inspected, whether there was a hearing scheduled. And he went to his vendor community and they said, great, you know, give us $20 million in 3 years and we'll get you a solution to that. Denise Ross, who some of you may know, also now works in federal government, said, I think we could take a different approach, a lighter weight approach to this problem. So we had three fellows go down there in 2012 and start talking to folks like Ms. Rita, who actually tracks all the blighted properties in her community already. She just does it in an enormous, she actually has this enormous map of her community on her wall, and she calls every day and figures out what's going on with all of her properties in her neighborhood, and she is a single source for all that information. We know that the people are already doing this. So they work with people like Ms. Rita, and then they work with all of the data owners in government. And it's really hard to get your hands on all of that data. But within a couple of weeks, they've been able to put up a minimum viable product in which you can enter any address in New Orleans, and it would return for you a very clear statement of whether that property, this property in particular, had been reported, inspected. There was a notice sent to the owner, it had been re-inspected, and the case had been heard, and that property had been judged to be blighted and was scheduled for demolition. And so the people in the community could actually know this, which was really, really important, because what had been happening is that there had been meetings between the neighborhood advocates and City Hall for so long, in which basically people just yelled at each other. People were so frustrated about the lack of understanding, but the fact that a property was scheduled to be demolished when they knew that so-and-so's brother was coming back to rehab that property. They were demolishing the wrong properties, and there was enormous tension between City Hall and the citizens around this issue. But when they could all look at this information and be literally on the same page, I got a call from Denise the first time they rolled this out of the LifeSat meeting in New Orleans, and she said, your team just did something amazing. They just changed the conversation. In fact, then Fast Company wrote about it. It was a completely different tone, where instead of yelling at each other, the neighborhood advocates and the folks on the in the City Hall who were on the Blightstone Committee were working productively together towards the right outcome so that the right properties were demolished. Sorry, I don't remember what my next slide is. Where do I point this?
Point it to the back of the room.
Oh, towards the back. I don't know, I'm pointing it towards the screen. Okay, towards the back, thank you. So this was like one of our most successful projects at Code for America. And that's why it surprised me one day when I came into the bathroom and Alex Kandel, who was one of the faces I showed earlier, was in the bathroom crying. And I said, Alex, what's wrong? I've asked her, by the way, if it was okay to tell the story. So I'm not, hopefully not embarrassing her too much. I know she's not here, but I do have her permission. And she said, you know, it's just the weight of the expectations on me. People in New Orleans think I can fix their problems, but I'm just a designer. but I think that's sort of part of what I want to say here, which is that designers have superpowers, and we all can be designers. And that superpower is really this. It's understanding user needs. This is, yet again, from our friends in the UK government. If you walked into the government digital service there, I think this is probably still there. It's a piece of butcher paper, and someone sort of just ripped out that middle piece and put it on the window so that when you look out, you're looking down on the street and you see people. And it's their reminder of who they are working for every single day. And I think that's part of what's happening in our community right now is we're saying, what is civic tech for? And what is government tech for? Why do we all get together on a regular basis to try to solve these problems? And I just would go back to that. Civic tech is for making government work for real people. And that's why we come together. And if we're going to do that, the for the people part, I think, can be pretty clear. I think the part that we're really all getting to now in the evolution of this movement is that it's not going to work at scale. It's not going to start being big enough to solve the problems that we face as a society if it's not also done by the people. Institutions have a very tough time scaling. People, communities, we can scale through people. I think it's resonant to do this here in Raleigh, the home of Red Hat, because that is sort of the fundamental principle. I think this is a quote from the Open Organization book. The beauty of an open organization is it's not about pedaling harder, but about tapping into new sources of power, both inside and outside, to keep pace with all the fast-moving changes in our environment. It sounds a lot to me like government as a platform, the core idea that got me into this and probably got a lot of you into this. It's a platform on which anybody can build the solution that they need, but we open it up to the community in order to do that. We can't be big unless it includes more people and all people and all kinds of people. And this is sort of the lesson of the consumer tech industry right now. Companies that are doing things at scale because they're bringing in anybody who wants to, or almost anybody who wants to, and having them work in a lightweight, on-demand sort of way. I'm reading both of these books right now. Actually, I can't believe I'm reading The Open Organization for the first time. I should be fired for that. I'm rereading Cognitive Surplus. And one of the things I would invite you all to talk to me about throughout the rest of the conference is how we can make sure that the movement for open government and government that works for people is built with a clear architecture of participation that feels great to everybody. I feel that when I'm here. I also feel the need to connect our communities around the country better, and I would love your thoughts and ideas about that. I want to return to this notion of who is coming into government, how is government working with non-government people, which is what I see here today, by wrapping up some of the stories that I talked about earlier. I talked about Mikey not feeling comfortable in government, not feeling like it's his environment, and yet he came to us in October 2013, and he stayed. He's been running the United States Digital Service in his rumpled t-shirt and cargo pants every day and doing amazing work to make our government technology work for the people of this country. That team that worked on the food stamps, I mentioned that they stayed there, still here, and not only are they taking this food stamps program to every California county and hopefully every state with low enrollment in the next couple of years, that program is also serving as a model of how we can scale the other work in our criminal justice system and in job training, which started in New Orleans this year. It's something that's going on, it's getting bigger, and it's having greater and greater impact. And then Tiffany, who I mentioned, who started Detroit Water Project, she actually demoed at Y Combinator and is now a full-fledged nonprofit that's taking her work far, far beyond where it just started. I wanted to end on a quick note again about sort of the nature of our community. This is a photo from an event that happened last year at Code for America. Just an open house that we had with Code for San Francisco. And we were showing off some of our Code for San Francisco projects and some of the Code for America Fellowship projects. And Jesse Burasak, who is now in Boston, but used to run Code for San Francisco, came up and was sort of standing beside me, and I was talking to a number of people from local government who were there, and he was just very politely waiting and waiting, and I finally was able to turn to him and say, "Hey, Jesse, what's going on?" And he had a woman next to him who he wanted to introduce me to. And he said, "You should meet Anne. Anne's been coming to Code for San Francisco events every Wednesday night here in your office for the past 6 months. And Anne just wanted to say something to you." And she said, "Jennifer, I wanted to thank you for creating this space." And I started my normal thing of like, "It's not me, this is really Jesse, he does this." And she said, "No, I want to thank you for creating this space. I've been living for the past year in a homeless shelter, and I have tried to be involved with every tech group in this city. And nobody has wanted me here except Code for San Francisco. And I've been coming here and helping out every Wednesday night for the past 6 months. And the thing that keeps me going, it's the community that sustains me." And I think that's sort of what I mean about who's doing solving. The fact that we created a space for Anne to be part of solving the problems in her community meant so much to me. And I think we can't do the work that we need to do if we don't remember. We're not solving problems for people, we're solving problems with people. that's just another way, really, of saying it's not just government for the people, it's government by the people. I'm at a point in my understanding of this movement where I need help to understand better how to do this by the people. So I'm here really to talk with all of you. If you've got ideas about how to connect all of this work together, please come talk to me. I'm really honored that you've welcomed me into this community, and thank you for having me back.